September 7th, 1996, 11 p.m. A black BMW cruises slowly down the Las Vegas Strip. Inside, rap and film star Tupac Shakur sits in the passenger seat. Death Row Records kingpin Marion Suge Knight is behind the wheel. No one sees the white Cadillac that slowly pulls up alongside, or the gun that's aimed directly at Tupac. Tupac is hit several times in the chest. He's rushed to the University Medical Center, but surgeons can't stop the internal bleeding. 6 days later, Tupac Shakur is dead.
All eyes on me. I cried right then when I heard. You know, anybody who loved him is still affecting him right now. Guaranteed. All eyes on
me. For 6 years, the mystery has lingered and taken on a mythic quality. Officially, the crime remains unsolved, but unofficially, theories abound. Many revolve around one central theme, the ongoing war between LA's Blood and Crip street gangs and their affiliations with East and West Coast rappers. But in early September, a new theory emerged and it rocked the music world. In the next half hour, VH1 News will talk to the main players, break down the night of the murder, and try to get to the bottom of the mystery: who killed Tupac Shakur? The Los Angeles Times ignited a firestorm of controversy when it reported that the man who approved the hit on Tupac Shakur was another rap star, the notorious B.I.G. L.A. Times music writer Chuck Phillips spent a year investigating the story. He says he learned that Biggie, whose real name was Christopher Wallace, agreed to pay the Crips $1 million for killing Tupac and even supplied the murder weapon.
According to various gang members, Biggie asked to have Tupac killed, asked the gang members to kill him.
Yet Biggie's friends say he couldn't have done it. The night of the murder, he was thousands of miles away.
It was a regular day. He was chilling. He wasn't in Vegas. He was home in Jersey.
In a statement, Biggie's family described the LA Times story as, quote, irresponsible journalism, and said they may file a lawsuit against the paper for, quote, untruthful statements and accusations.
There have been discussions about it, but nothing concrete has actually been, you know what I'm saying, set in stone. So until such time, there's nothing really to discuss.
The last hours of Tupac Shakur's life began, like so many of his gangster rap lyrics, with an act of violence. On September 7th, Tupac met up with Suge Knight in Las Vegas to attend a Mike Tyson heavyweight fight at the MGM Grand Hotel. Among those in attendance, members of LA's infamous street gangs.
They came out to attend the fight. Basically, they'd done this for a decade, where they would go to every major fight.
At 8:45 p.m., Tupac and Knight headed for the exit, accompanied by an armed group of Piru Bloods, a Compton street gang whose members were on Death Row's payroll. In the MGM lobby, someone noticed a member of the arch-rival Southside Crips standing near the elevators. The Crip was Orlando Baby Lane Anderson, who months earlier had beaten and robbed one of Tupac's bodyguards. Tape from an MGM hotel security camera shows what happened next. In a flash, Tupac, Suge, and others from the group jumped Anderson, punching and kicking him to the ground. Terrified bystanders scattered as the group streamed into the casino, then out into the street. That's what we know. Phillips' account of what happened next was gleaned from interviews with investigators and anonymous gangsters, many talking for the first time. The LA Times reports that over the next 2 hours, a roughed-up Anderson, vowing revenge, quickly organized a meeting with his fellow Crips at the Treasure Island Hotel. There, they devised a plan to take their revenge.
It's hard for a lot of people to understand that a beating like that would result in a killing. But in the gang world, you know, dignity and honor is the whole thing. And disrespect it's something they do not tolerate. And it's really a strong code of ethics. And so an infraction like that, where you beat somebody up in front of everybody at a major hotel when other gang members are present, you've just really invited a murder.
The Crips told Phillips they then arranged a secret meeting with Tupac's greatest rival, Biggie Smalls. once the best of friends, Tupac and Biggie were embroiled in a bitter public feud, fueled by dueling record labels, threats, and Tupac's claim that he had sex with Biggie's wife.
You claim to be a player, but I bust your wife. We bust on bad boys, brothers touch for life.
According to Phillips, the Crips met with Biggie, who was staying in a suite under an assumed name at the MGM, and asked him to pay $1 million for the hit.
Biggie agreed to the thing and provided a gun.
A 40 caliber Glock semi-automatic. At 10:30 p.m., Tupac and Suge, leading a procession of fancy cars, drove north on Las Vegas Boulevard. They then turned right onto Flamingo Road towards Suge's night spot, Club 662. At 11 p.m., Anderson and three other Crips set off in search of Tupac. Heading out of the Treasure Island Valet parking circle in their white Cadillac, they linked up with another car and drove south on Las Vegas Boulevard. When they turned onto Flamingo Road, fate intervened. Just ahead, Suge Knight's black BMW.
They're stunned that this group of guys that they want to hit is right there. And so they say, let's do it right now. And they, you know, quickly move up right next to him. And according to other people, Tupac was talking to the left, you know, looking out the left when they pulled up on the right. And they pulled right up next to him and ripped off like 13 shots very quickly.
A panic Suge drove his bullet-ridden sedan across the median and crashed into a curb. Las Vegas police rushed to the scene and called an ambulance for the gravely wounded Tupac. He would die 6 days later, his family by his side.
I walked in the room to visit him, and he was shaking the whole bed. He was a warrior, you know, to the end.
According to Phillips, the Crips escaped undetected, speeding back on I-15 to Los Angeles in the dead of night. In the days following the shooting, the Vegas police made little headway in their investigation. Detectives reviewed the MGM security tape of the Orlando Anderson beating, but did not connect the incident to the murder.
We've looked at it several times. We have no indication or actually nothing that it's going to lead us in a direction to arrest anyone that was involved.
On October 2nd, Compton, California police detained Anderson as part of a gang roundup to curb violence in the wake of the murder. And although Las Vegas police questioned Anderson, they apparently didn't think much of his possible connection to the murder.
That was the only time Las Vegas police interviewed Orlando Anderson, and it was very briefly.
Anderson denied knowing anything about Tupac's murder and was released.
No, I was not involved. I mean, I'm like a victim. You know what I'm saying? I feel, you know what I'm saying, sorry for him. And, you know, like I said, I was a fan of him.
Less than 2 years later, Anderson was killed in an apparently unconnected shooting. There have been few leads since.
The one thing that shouldn't have been done was you don't throw up your hands, and that's what the Las Vegas police did. That's a problem.
And then, in March 1997, Biggie himself was gunned down in Los Angeles. In an eerily similar circumstance, he was shot as he sat in his blazer at a traffic light on Wilshire Boulevard. The case remains unsolved. Coming up, Biggie's family and friends fight back, plus the roots of the feud.
One man against one man made a whole West Coast hate a whole East Coast.
When Who Killed Tupac Shakur returns.